Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Departures by E.J. Wenstrom, narrated by Jillian Yetter. Chapter 1. Evie. This is how I hope they remember me. Bathed in rainbow bright lights, dotted in glitter. The toll of my favorite dress swooshing around me as I bound through the pounding music on the dance floor. My cheeks flushed, heart thudding, alive. That's the point, after all. Tonight is my departure party. We've finally gotten past the terrible, emotional departure rituals, the look back at my life's highlights, my speech of goodbyes. My final hours are passing too fast, but I'm relieved these rituals are behind me. I had to fill them out with fudged memories to draw out softened, saccharine sentiments, the edges sanded down. I had to stretch out my short life to fit the typical timeframes. Most departure parties have to encompass a rich, long life of 100 years plus. Tonight, all I've got to cover is 17. It's not enough. But what do you do? I know what you don't do. You don't sulk on your last night on this planet. Not when it won't do you any good and only devastate the few people you really care about. No chance. You take your remaining fun where you can get it. Or at least, you try not to ruin it for everyone else. So I dance. I let the thudding bass roll over me and drown out my thoughts. The lights of the Quad's event center are dimmed, transforming the great room and its arched white beams into splashes of moving colors. Rainbow bright lights drift from floor to ceiling to windows, blocking out the Quad beyond. Pink fading to purple, fading to blue, fading to green. The music turns up. Never more than the maximum recommended volume, of course. Careful to stay within Directorate recommendations for optimal health. My guests, neighbors, former teachers, my peers from across our Quad, stand from their tables on cue, and the dance floor begins to fill. Glitter drops over us, like the night mist that keeps the plant life within the Quad dome green. Everyone smiles and bobs along to the beat. I mirror them, determined to keep my own smile in place, no matter what. My little sister Gracelyn, the one person I actually want here right now, weaves through the shuffling crowd until she finds me. She smiles too, though her eyes glisten with a hint of tears at their edges. No, don't cry. That's what kills me the most about all this. I can't stand to see her hurting. I take her hand and squeeze it, pulling my smile even bigger, and twirl her around. When she turns back to me, the light is back in her eyes, even if a hint of tears still glistens in the corners. We jump and twist to the beat, through the glitter raining from the ceiling, both of us determined to make the most of every minute I have left. Too soon, curfew nears. The music turns down. The people settle down in response, and the Quad's mayor takes the mic.
Thank you, Evalee Henders, for the gift of your presence in this Quad, she says, following the script of the ritual.
As I take my place next to her on the stage, I look out at the event hall. Expressions have turned somber.
We have one last gift to you. May your passage be as peaceful and painless as your life.
She hands me a small white box. I open it and look at the translucent pill every citizen takes to trigger their departure, the serum sloshing inside it. A quake of fear washes over me, and I hope no one can tell. The whole point of departure is to avoid all that. The pain and struggle of whatever death would have waited for me around the next corner. Departure isn't the thing to be afraid of, I remind myself. Not departing is. All the same, my heartbeat speeds up until everything starts to turn blurry. I blink hard, trying to push the panic down. Young as I am, this night will be talked about for years. The last thing I want is for something bad to be said about the way I went. I want to be remembered as strong, brave. I force my fear deep into my gut, nod in acknowledgement of the gift, and push it into my mouth before I can think anymore. Even as its sweetness dissolves on my tongue and the serum releases, a calming buzz quells my anxiety. The first taste of its promise to slowly pull me into a deep, everlasting sleep over the course of the night. Hands raise in applause and everyone cheers, a final affirmation of my life. Then, the normal overhead lights switch on, and the magic of the color-bright dance floor dies. Like a spell has been lifted, my guests turn away, gathering their things and chit-chatting politely as they file towards the exit. After all, everyone else, whose lives will go on tomorrow, must get their full night of sleep to maintain optimal health and happiness. Chapter 2, Evie. The guests filter out of the event hall and onto the waiting shuttle buses, a line of rounded silver trolleys waiting in a line near the doors. They will deliver us to our assigned neighborhoods, which surround the quad center, in a carefully designed ring for optimal flow. Already, the quad's white dome sky has started to fade to darkness as curfew approaches, and the usual soothing notes of the bedtime wind-down cue pipe in from the dome and into the vehicle. Mother yawns in response. Gracelyn, Mother, Father, and I get in line and step onto Shuttle Bus 11, corresponding to our assigned neighborhood, find seats for the short ride home, and buckle in. A silence hangs heavy between us, leaving the usual stream of friendly announcements and warnings to fill the space in a warm, paternal voice.
This is where you belong. Stay in your seat when the bus is moving. A healthy citizen is a happy friend. Be diligent in your daily fitness. Mind the step as you exit the shuttle bus, and always hold the handrail for safety. Notice something out of place? Be a friend and notify the nearest directorate official.
It is only minutes before the shuttle bus slows to a stop at the park of our neighborhood. Each neighborhood's park is in the center, a short trek from the identical manicured homes that surround it, each neatly framed with a sidewalk and tree. As my parents, Gracelyn and I, make the walk, the silence between us grows thicker. A watch lizard's bulbous lens head tilts up at us as its electronic body whirs past our feet, its stubbly tail waggling for balance, off to some new post. I stick out my tongue to whoever is watching the feed, an unnecessary act of reckless rebellion. But what does it matter now? As we approach the paneled door labeled Henders, Father lifts his wrist to the laser scanner at its side to scan his digipad, and it slides open. It slides closed again behind us, and we all trudge up the stairs together. Tonight, the mellow beige of the walls, the auto dim of the lights, and the calming low tones of bedtime music reach me through a distorted filter of the serum in the pill from the ceremony, growing thicker in my veins. At the top of the stairs, I turn for my room, but am pulled back by Mother. She wraps her arms around me, tight for a final embrace. I echo her gesture, and then start to let her go, but she holds me tighter, refusing to release me. Her thin fingers like eight little pressure points across my shoulders, and it feels like the weight of her sadness is leaking into me. We're not supposed to be sad. The directorate handles everything to make sure of it. But her cheek presses against mine, and her breaths turn jagged and uneven, and she's still clinging to me tightly, until it starts to scare me, and finally I look to Father.
All right then, dear,
he says, putting a strong hand around her forearm.
That's enough.
Father pulls her away and helps her to one of her small pills. Father echoes her movement, a rapid circle of his arms around me, and then he is gone, guiding Mother to their room at the far end of the hall. Her breaths are already starting to settle back into their normal, sedated rhythm. We go to our rooms without our usual good nights. Caught up in the routine of life, I go into the bathroom. I unpin my hair from the fancy twists and curls Mother insisted on for tonight's party and let it loose. But then, my hand halfway to my toothbrush, I freeze. What's the point? The only ones who will see me tomorrow are the departure crew who come for my body. My arm drops back to my side. Not knowing what else to do, I return to my room. The serum's soothing buzz makes the crisp white comforter and two tidy pillows of my bed look even more inviting than usual. But I can't give in to it yet. Not until I've talked to Gracelyn. I hear her shuffling in the bathroom, washing her face and brushing her hair. For her, tomorrow will come. For several long moments, I stare at the calming blue walls, dazed. The serum is turning everything slightly blurry, even my thoughts. Idly, I wish I'd cleaned my room before the party. In the closet, a couple of shirts have fallen from their hangers and lie crumpled on the floor. The chair for my desk, the sink screen mounted above it on the wall. Everything is slightly out of place. Typical. Even though our standard issue bedrooms are exactly the same, mine has never had the crisp, clean look Gracelyn's always does. But there was so much happening today, I didn't think of it. And now I am sure that on the serum, I would only make it worse. The lamps on the desk and the nightstand, all the same rich brown of eco-friendly plastics modeled into faux wood grain, continue to dim, counting down to bedtime. The bathroom door opens, then closes again, and I am about to go to Gracelyn's room when she taps lightly on my door. We've been doing this after our parents go to sleep for years, basically our whole lives. I go to the door and let her in. A few tears drop down her cheeks. Guilt tangles through my chest and into my gut. I've done this to her with my own stupidity and selfishness. The Directorate advised keeping us apart from the day my parents found out Gracelyn was coming. It was better for her, for all of us, they said, to avoid letting us get close. It was unlucky enough, having one daughter with such an early departure date. It didn't have to impact the other one, too. But when we were young, I didn't understand. And I was lonely. My life was pretty empty, with those numbers printed on my wrist for everyone to see. The other children weren't allowed to play with me. They didn't want that bond weighing them down later. My instructors didn't put any effort into teaching me. I had to do it all myself. When I got older and began to understand, I tried to stop the bond growing between Gracelyn and me. I really did. But Gracelyn wouldn't give up. She kept sitting outside my bedroom door for hours every single night, ruining her rest metrics. Her medical advisor started getting concerned about her sleep count. Finally, I let her in. She's only a year younger than me, but if there was one thing I've been good at, it's been protecting her. I've guarded her in dark nights when she used to get nightmares about the desolate world that lay beyond the quad bubbles. I've helped her through the stress of her annual examinations. I've shielded her from Mother and Father when they got too intense about her future. But now, seeing the tears clouding her big brown eyes and making tracks down her pale cheeks, I can't help but face what I've let happen. I've hurt her. She's the one who will pay the price for years and years after I'm gone. Don't do that, I whisper, wiping another tear away from her cheek. Be happy, always. She shakes her head and presses the heels of her hands into her eyes. I will, I promise. You don't have to worry about me. When she pulls her hands away, her eyes are red from the rubbing, but dry. Here, I hand her a little box. Purple, her favorite color. She opens it and pulls out the golden chain, with my favorite daisy pendant dangling from it. Oh, she sighs. I've worn it every day since mother and father gave it to me, the day Gracelyn was born. The tip of her mouth pulls into the hint of a smile, and she puts it on. Then she takes off her own necklace, a rose pendant, and stretches it out to me. Gracelyn, I ask. Take it, she says. No way, that's stupid, I say, stepping back. If you give it to me, it'll get... Her lip starts trembling. Just take it, okay? It'll feel like you have a piece of me with you. Anything to keep her from crying. I stretch my hand out and close it over hers. Okay, okay. If that's what you want. I love it. I'll wear it. Always. She nods and tips her palm open, so the necklace falls into my hand. I put it on and pull at the collar of my dress to show her. See? She smiles. The serum sedative is growing heavier, wrapping around me like a warm, fuzzy blanket. And the last thing I want is for Gracelyn to see me collapse into my final sleep. I hug her, and she squeezes me so tight that my lungs strain. I almost say something, but really, at this point, what does it matter? You need to sleep, I scold her. Go. She squeezes me a moment longer. When she finally lets go, she turns away too fast, her shoulders shaking, and I know she is crying again. I want to go after her, but the serum is taking over. I give in, flopping onto my bed and letting the blackness set in, unable to fight it any longer. Chapter 3, Evie. Consciousness creeps in through a thick fog. The first thing I'm aware of is the striking lack of citrus in the air, used by the Directorate to heighten alertness each morning. I tell myself I must have longer to sleep, but then I realize sunlight is pushing in from the window behind my eyelids. Something is off, but my mind is too hazy for me to care. I groan, and my throat is scratchy and dry. My mouth tastes stale and mucky, and my body feels heavy. Like if I ever moved again, it would be too soon. All I want is to rest, to go on lying here forever, sunk into the comforting cushion of my bed. But slowly, awareness creeps in like the sunlight, unwelcome and intrusive. When I finally realize why everything feels so off, I bolt upright. There's no wake-up cues, because I wasn't supposed to wake up. Not today. Not ever again. My head sloshes in response to the sudden movement, and the Directorate serum still thick in my blood. Despite it, because of it, my heart races until I'm sure it will explode. The dread melts into my fingers, turning them shaky and numb. Then I'm falling too fast to hang on, even as I cling to the sides of the bed. Is this it? Is this how I end? Did I wake up too soon? I wait, brace myself. For anything, for the nothingness sure to come any second to relieve this attack on my senses. For my heart to burst, for my body to seize, I don't know. My heart just goes on raging faster still, harder than it's ever gone, even in the stress tests during my medical exams. I wait for the corresponding alarm on my digipad to start, for the AI to tell me how to calm myself, to alert someone that I am still here, so they will come and fix this. But it doesn't. No one is monitoring my vitals anymore. My labored breaths fill my ears, rising and falling far too fast. I stare down at my hands, trying to calm myself. Trace a finger over the departure date inked into my wrist. The lettering is clear and leaves no room for misinterpretation. Not that I could have gotten it wrong after 17 years of fixating on it. And my parents, my instructors, everyone. It was the same thing every time. 17 years, they'd exclaim. How? Why? Parents would pull their children back from me as if they could catch it. But what can you do? The directorate doesn't decide when your departure date is. Its technology just provides the information. Make sure you get as much life as you can before it becomes more pain than good. Then it makes sure you don't suffer. Everything always goes as planned. That's the directorate's promise. Everything else out in the world beyond its domes may have turned toxic and wasted and ruined, but here in the quads, everything is optimized and controlled and perfect. I should do something. The thought is mushy in my head through the serum's haze, and I can't quite get a grasp on it. I stand, slowly, testing out my legs. The floor gives a creak in response. I try to step forward, lose my balance, plop back onto the bed. As I wait for my room to stop spinning, for any tiny part of this to start making sense, footsteps shuffle in the next room, and I hear the door open. Gracelyn's up. She pauses in the hall. Instinct forces me to keep still. It's not until her steps fade down the stairs that the thought takes shape, through the fog of my mind, that maybe I should have called out to her. No, no, no. I shake my head and try to get my thoughts straight. I could still depart at any moment. Last thing I want is for Gracelyn to see it happen. I'm not ruining a perfectly good, lifelong streak of looking out for her now. The doorbell rings. The departure crew's here. No one else would dare come by today. Another set of footsteps go downstairs and stumble towards the front door. The door opens. Low, murmuring voices, professional and cool, offer condolences like reciting a script. Then they start up the stairs. My skin goes strange and prickly. The steps stop outside my room. The doorknob shifts and twists. I freeze up as muscles I never knew had tense up. Then a pause. I want to shout to them, "I'm here, I'm alive." But my thoughts skid against the serum, out of balance, and I can't find hold.
"Why don't you head to the kitchen, get yourself some coffee?"
The voice from the other side of the door is kind, though there's a stiffness in it.
"Yes,"
Father's voice agrees. He's always raspy in the morning.
"Yes, I think I will."
I wish he wouldn't sound so solemn, for Gracelyn's sake. He shuffles back down the stairs. Then the door opens. My hands squeeze into fists at my sides, cramming my fingers painfully into fistfuls of mattress. What's going to happen to me? I'm not ready. Chapter 4. Evie. A man and a woman stand in the doorway in standard departure crew jumpsuits, a crisp light blue. The woman has short dark hair that springs around her head in curls. The man is tall, with speckles of gray streaked through his sandy beard. Their name tags read Ronnie and Charles. As the door swings wide, Ronnie leans into Charles, whispering. He smiles. Then they look to the bed and see me there, sitting up and very much alive. Charles starts, knocking the fold-out stretcher out of Ronnie's hand and creating a clatter of cheap metal against the hard floor of the hallway. Ronnie's face drains of color. "I'll be damned," she breathes. My fingers ache, and I realize how tightly my fists are digging into the mattress. I loosen my grip and place my hands on my thighs, pressing my fingers over the fabric of my favorite blue dress. I was so exhausted after the departure party last night that I never took it off. And now it's horribly wrinkled. Mother's voice rises in my mind, scolding me for looking such a mess. And then I remember that right now, this is the least of my problems. Ronnie and Charles are still staring at me, wide-eyed and gaping. From downstairs, the faint hum of the food printer drifts in. My stomach rumbles. I'd kill for something to eat right now. Ronnie glances towards the stairs, then shoves Charlie into my room and closes the door behind them. Charlie blinks.
Are you?
He looks at his chart.
Evalee Henders?
I shrug and look down to my scrunched toes. Evie. Forming words is harder than normal. My lips are stiff and slow from the serum.
Why?
Ronnie's expression shifts, her features sharpening into anger.
I don't know what you're playing at, but your time is up.
Shh.
Charles scolds, grabbing her arm. He nods towards the door. Ronnie shakes her arm away from him and continues, but her voice lowers to a hissing whisper.
Are you Licentia? You won't get away with this. We'll...
She's looking around. Maybe for something to use as a weapon? Like she needs to defend herself against me. Anger rumbles over me and quakes.
Licentia? The terrorist cult isn't even real. Nothing more than whispers people trade when something goes wrong, so they have something to blame for it.
How dare she compare my accidental aliveness with the mass acts of intentional chaos that have become entangled with their legends? Worse, somewhere deep under my anger, I can feel my foundation crumbling, fear shaking itself loose. Because it's clear from the look in their eyes that Ronnie and Charlie did not expect this. And that means there is no plan. The Directorate always has a plan. And everything stays perfectly in place because of it. It would be less scary if this was all some sort of Licentia plot. Without a plan, everything falls apart. I cling to the anger instinctively to fight back questions too big for me to deal with.
I'm no terrorist, I exclaim. I took the pill, but here I am.
I hear my words slurring, feel the world slipping, 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 but can't make it stop.
How can I know that?
Ronnie steps closer to me, her face reddening. She shoves me.
What are you playing at? How'd you do it? Don't you know your place?
My place? I don't have a place in this world anymore. I never did, really.
Hey, now.
Charles pulls Ronnie back.
Something went wrong, but it's not her fault. Look at her.
It's not my fault. The phrase echoes through my head. My shoulders loosen, releasing painful tension all the way down my back. It still feels like the world is flying out of orbit, but it helps. Ronnie takes a deep breath, shakes her head.
Okay, she says. You're right. But Charlie, what the hell do we do?
Charlie gives her a weak smile.
No idea.
And then they both stare at me. I stare back. I'm supposed to be departed. I'm realizing what it means on a new level now. The fact that I'm sitting up and breathing. It's like the ground is crumbling away from under me, but I can't move to get away. I press my arms over my middle, just to feel that my stomach's still there. But the anger takes over and forces my mind into action. We have to figure out what went wrong so I can get back to my life, so we can fix the plan. And clearly they can't give me those answers here. Maybe this was some kind of weird inking glitch, and I actually have another 100 years. Or maybe it was only off by a few days. I have to know before I just stroll out to the kitchen like it's any other morning.
Don't you have protocols?
I ask. Charlie blinks.
Not for this.
Protocol?
Ronnie purses her lips, then glances back to Charlie.
Right. Let's get her to the creme like usual. That's where she's supposed to be. Let the higher-ups figure out what to do about it.
Right,
Charlie responds. He's bolstering up a little too, following Ronnie's lead. But how will we get her out of... Oh! Ronnie bends over and lifts the body bag and folded up stretcher.
It'll look like any other pickup.
Seriously?
I pound a fist against my bed. It's not enough that I'm supposed to be dead right now. You want me to actually act like it? They jump at my profanity. We don't talk about death in the Directorate. Not outright like that. Their panicked reaction is satisfying, though. It's nice to see I'm not alone in being completely freaked out.
Ronnie pulls herself together and unfolds the stretcher. Have a better idea? This is all I got.
I rack my brain. Nothing. Shit. I moan. Clinks of coffee cups and plates carry from downstairs. And I feel inexplicably homesick. I'd kill for some coffee right now.
Ronnie ignores me and lays out the bag between us on the floor. It's black, made out of some kind of thin but sturdy material. One of those optimized hybrids the Directorate uses to minimize waste. It looks scratchy and uncomfortable. But then I guess when you're departed, that doesn't bother you.
I grimace. How many corpses have been in this thing? Lost count. Get in.
Now that we have a plan, Ronnie isn't playing games. She nods to it, her hands on her hips.
Fear flares inside me. But underneath it, I have to admit I'm relieved someone is taking charge.
Come on now, think of your family,
Charlie adds. My hand drifts mindlessly to the rose pendant around my neck. I've never been more grateful for anything in my life. I need Gracelyn right now, even if this is as close as I can get. I huff out a heavy breath and drop to the floor. I try to push down the panic rising through my chest and slip myself into the bag. It's made to fit much larger people, and as Charlie zips it closed, I feel as if I'm being swallowed into a crinkly void.
He pauses when he gets to my head.
Don't worry, kid. We got coffee on site.
Then the blackness zips over my face, and all the promises in the world wouldn't comfort me.
Chapter 5. Gracelyn. I wake up to a creak from the other side of the wall. I'm still half asleep, and my first thought, the automatic thought, is that Evie is really getting a move on this morning. She is never up before me. Then reality rushes back. Last night's party, the final goodbyes, the tight squeeze of Evie's arms wrapped around me, and the tears crowding her green eyes before we went to our rooms at the end of it all. My hand drifts to my neck and traces over her daisy pendant. Evie is not up. Evie is departed. The departure crew must already be here. I glance to my digipad. 824. Guess they are the ones getting an early move on. I get up and do the recommended full body stretch routine, then press the button on the wall to raise the curtain. Light pours in through the branches of the large tree that stretches out between my room and Evie's, matching the gradually brightening lamps in my room. Evie is departed. I repeat it to myself to test it out, but all I feel is a terrible nothing. Though it has been a constant looming presence over my 16 years, now that it is here, it doesn't feel real. In the hallway, everything is quiet. The only sound, the smart house's electric hum rumbling within the clean beige walls. Did mother and father let the departure crew in and then go back to bed? That seems odd. But then, how could I know what is normal for a departure day? I pause by Evie's door. Its crisp white color scuffed at the corners from carelessness. Then stumble down the stairs. In a daze of numbness, I pull one of our standard-issue white eco-plastic mugs from the cabinet and set it in place at the food printer. I scan my digipad and select my first coffee. As the drip of steaming liquid fills it with a whir, Father appears.
Good morning.
He smiles, but it's not his normal smile. It seems heavy under his mustache, like the motion causes him pain. Usually, this type of behavior would get a person reported to emotion management. But allowances are given for a departure. It is why we get this day off. Morning. I don't bother smiling back. How long are they going to take up there?
Who's where?
Father yawns, pulling out his own cup and putting his digipad up to the sensor. The crew. I can't bring myself to say departure. I didn't think it would take so long. Are they cleaning her entire room up there? Evie's room is always a mess, like a tornado got trapped in it. Was. It was always a mess. Soon it will just be an extra empty space. Father frowns and checks his digipad.
They won't be here for a few more minutes.
Goosebumps rise over my arms. But I heard someone up there.
Maybe it was the tree's branches rustling.
The doorbell rings.
There they are now,
Father says. He heads to the door and lets them in. A woman's voice greets Father at the door, gruff and businesslike. And while they exchange pleasantries, my mind struggles to reconcile what I heard and what is possible. My thoughts drift to the idea of Evie's empty, limp body in her bed. I cringe and try to shake the image away. We do not think of such things. That is what the departure crew is for, after all. I redirect my mind to last night. The two of us dancing under rainbow lights and sparkles. Evie, beautiful and alive. Her hair all done up in elaborate swirls, pinned back on her head. Even though she hates that kind of thing. Hated. Hello. Mother comes down the stairs as Father leads the crew up. Her greeting has a strained chirpiness to it. They murmur a response and keep going. Mother rounds the corner to the kitchen and goes right for the coffee. As she waits for it, she turns and smiles at me. Her deep brown eyes are bloodshot and unfocused. Her usually tight curls are loose and messy, like she has just rolled out of bed. And her skin, usually bright with impeccable makeup, is pallid and wrinkled. I cannot believe she is downstairs like this, let alone that she let the departure crew see her. Father returns. For a moment, we all stare at the floor. Then the coffee drip stops, leaving behind a vacuum of silence. What are you two moping for? Mother asks. Her voice feels overanimated and out of control. I'm starved. Let's eat. Somehow, I'd forgotten about breakfast. We line up in front of the printer again, and one by one, we scan our digipads and take our meals. Then we sit around the table. I pick at the protein square and carbs, but can't seem to force it down. Across from me, Evie's seat is painfully empty. Mother and Father avoid looking at it. Raised voices and a metallic clatter cut the quiet from upstairs. I glance to Mother and Father. Mother picks up the small pill that dispensed onto her plate with her meal and swallows it. Father focuses on his food, refusing to look up. That's weird, right? I say.
Mm-mm.
Father's voice trails off. It occurs to me that maybe they have not been present for a collection before. I have never asked. They have never said. It is not something that is discussed.
I'm sure they know what they're doing, Mother nods. They're professionals.
None of us want to go up there. We're not supposed to. We eat. We wait. We go through the motions, pretending it is a normal morning. Evie's empty chair glares at me from across the table. A few minutes later, the departure crew comes back down the stairs and shuffles through the front door. It is a normal morning now, exactly what every morning will be moving forward. I stare into my square of carbs. Something feels off, and it's not just that Evie is gone. I heard something before the departure crew got here. But I couldn't have. right? Chapter 6, Evie. It's like a dark mark, having a sky blue departure crew van outside your home. Everyone knows what's happening. Not that it's talked about. It would be rude to remind someone of their loss when they're supposed to be moving on. It's one of the things the departure dates have given us. We get to say our goodbyes and let go, so we can move on without the baggage. Neat and tidy, like everything else about life in the quads. So we can continue to thrive by the official directorate definition. And that's good. I didn't want to be a source of pain for my family in an otherwise painless world. Even if the thought of them tucking memories of me away and moving on like healthy citizens makes me feel like something is tearing out my heart. But maybe now that won't have to happen. It's a bumpy ride out of the house and into the van, alone in the dark of the body bag. To keep myself quiet, I slowly, so as to not move visibly from outside the bag, tighten my fists and focus on the pressure of my nails digging into my palms. Ronnie and Charlie set me down gently, sort of, onto a hard surface, and then I hear a door pull down and fasten. The trunk. They dropped me in the trunk. The van shifts as they settle into their seats, and the engine hums to life. Ronnie calls out, "Stay down back there. If anyone sees you through the windows, they'll have a heart attack." I poke my finger through at the zipper's end and work it down around my face. "Are you kidding? This thing reeks," I say. It does. Acidic and sharp, like the chemistry room after a lab day. And under that, I imagine I can smell the stench of all the corpses that were stored in here before me. I don't care if it's crazy. I smell it. "Well, unzip a little if you have to. But for the love of all that is good, stay out of sight." Good? All we have here is a massive screw-up. I almost say it out loud, but Ronnie's voice quivers with tension, and it reminds me too much of the fear still ringing at the back of my own mind. As we pull onto the road, I stare at the van's ceiling. I breathe in and my nose crinkles. It smells almost as bad in the van as it did inside the bag. Old, kind of mildewy. Not at all in line with the departure crew vehicle's shiny, polished exteriors. But what's it really matter? I'm in the back of an old van, lying in a body bag on my way to the creme. Everyone I know believes I'm departed. I might as well be departed. I'm going through all the motions. My mouth feels sticky and dry and stale. My stomach rumbles again. Coffee. Charlie promised me coffee when we get there. Maybe he can get me something to eat, too. Then my mind pulls back. This is what I'm worried about right now? It's maybe about 9 now. On a normal day, one where I'm not supposed to be departed, I would have eaten about 2 hours ago and then gone to school. No, in a normal life, one where I had 100 years plus like everyone else, I'd have a career to go to, like Gracelyn will start tomorrow. But for me, all that training would have been a waste of directorate resources. Maybe I'll get a new departure date now, and a career assignment to go with it. I test the idea out. I can see myself returning. Gracelyn's eyes growing wide with amazement. Mother blinking back tears. Father standing and staring, unable to take it in. I'm so used to blocking myself off to any plans after this point. I have a hard time finding my own reaction. But I know I'd do anything for more time. We slow down, and the rumble of trucks rises, passing around us in different directions. The van rolls over a series of bumps, tossing me within the bag. Then we stop, and the engine turns off. "Do we take her in with us?" Ronnie asks. "Hmm," Charlie muses. I expect him to say more, but he doesn't. "Don't leave me here!" My voice is high-pitched and scratchy, and I realize how scared I am.
Okay, Ronnie says. But we should take her in the bag again, don't you think, Charlie?
Yeah.
I'm starting to feel Charlie's contributions to this whole thing are questionable at best. I let out a loud huff. Fine. I squirm around to pull the zipper back up over my head the best I can. Let's go. I swear I hear a snicker from Ronnie in the front. Jeez, kid, okay. The front doors open and shut with a burst of rumbling vehicles. Then the back pops open with a gust of ashy odor. They lift me out, not bothering with the stretcher this time, and I try to give in to the slouch of the bag as they carry me. The door slides shut behind us, and we stop. They place me on a hard floor. A cheap bell dinks. Pickup van 829. We need to talk with Viv ASAP. Ronnie enunciates the letters, as if each is its own word. A new voice, male but chirpy, responds.
Viv is pretty tied up this morning, but she could see you around too if you could.
You don't understand. We need to see Viv immediately. We've had an irregularity with our first pickup of the day. We can't go back out until we see her. Ronnie's voice is getting tense. I imagine her face flushing with the frustration, like it did in my room.
An irregularity? The man responds. Well, yes, I'll be right back.
Desk chair wheels clatter, and then steps move briskly away. Ronnie sighs.
There now, Charlie replies.
Fingers tap against a countertop. The air inside the body bag grows hot. As I start to sweat, the material sticks to my skin, creating a feeling of walls closing in. I slowly stretch out my fingers and flex my toes, fighting the impulse to rip myself free, while also wondering if maybe I should, because this is all so incredibly horrible and stupid. But you don't go against the Directorate. And I'm already going against the Directorate just by being alive. I know on a gut level that it's going to be better for me if I can avoid making a scene about it. Footsteps come back towards us.
Viv will see you now.
Thank you so much, Ronnie says. They lift me off the ground.
Oh, the assistant says. Do you really need to take the bag? Let's put that.
Yes, we do need the bag.
It's Charlie this time, with more bite in his voice than I'd have guessed him capable of.
Of course, the other man says. This way, please.
We trail behind a set of footsteps, the creak of a door, a turn, and I'm on the ground again.
Viv will be in shortly.
The door closes, leaving behind an uncomfortable silence.
Whoa,
Charlie asks.
Yeah, I guess we can let her out, Ronnie says.
The zipper tugs away and the bag falls open. Charlie stares down at me, a serious twitchiness about his mouth. I push myself up. We're in a plain office. Ronnie and Charlie are perched near a couple of chairs, shoulders tense and hands in pockets. Across from us is a desk, all in standard eco-plastic wood grain. The walls are a dull white gray, and I wonder if they were painted that color, or if they have faded over time from the ash in the air outside from the creme. Even in here, I'm sure I can smell it. The tail of a watch lizard scurries away under the crack of the door, and panic surges in my veins. You haven't done anything wrong, I remind myself. Ronnie's eyes flit to the door's crack and then meet mine. She saw it too. The three of us stand there staring at one another. Nothing to say, until the door flies open. A small woman bursts through it with short, wavy hair, streaked with gray. A suit jacket is thrust over her shoulders, like it's struggling to keep up. She starts talking before she is even through the door.
I've only got a few minutes, so let's get right to the...
She turns to face us and freezes as her eyes reach mine, then drop to the bag and back again. A stunned look wraps over her face. She opens her mouth to say something, but before she can, the door reopens and the voice from the front desk cuts her off.
I'm sorry, I forgot to ask if anyone would like any coffee or to. Oh!
A lean young man with pale skin and delicate glasses pops in and jumps as he sees me. If one more person reacts this way to simply seeing me breathing, I might scream. But the man recovers and continues with a polite smile.
Anyone? Coffee? Tea? Water, too?
His eyes only flit nervously back to me once. His white shirt is crisp, and his hair meticulously gelled back. Unlike Viv, he looks like he belongs in an office. He can't be more than a couple years older than me.
Coffee, I exclaim.
My stomach rumbles again. Coffee will at least hold me over better than the nothing I've got now.
Please, I tag on, regaining some degree of composure.
The rest of them shake their heads.
Thank you, Tad,
Viv says, dismissing him. Tad nods and ducks out, closing the door behind him. Viv settles into her desk, and her sink screen rises from within it, a flat, thin rectangle.
So,
she says. She straightens out her face into something attempting normality.
I take it this is, your pickup?
Yeah, she wasn't departed. Ronnie responds, echoing Viv's movement and settling into one of the chairs. Charlie follows suit.
We wanted to follow protocol as much as possible, but we figured taking her to the creme vault was not appropriate.
They figured?
As if they really might have dropped me for cremation and gone on their way.
Certainly, Viv agrees. There's actually a...
She leans forward and taps madly at her screen.
A contingency plan for this type of, no.
She taps again, then drags something else forward and searches more.
Oh, okay.
So there is a protocol. My stomach churns, and I can't decide if this makes me feel better or worse. Has this happened before? How many times? Why haven't I ever heard about it? The door pops open. It's Tad again. That dumb, polite smile still matted to his face.
Your coffee, miss.
He hands me a white mug, same as we use at home, standard issue. The familiar, welcoming smell steaming from it. I glance from him to the three hovering over Viv's screen and back again. I don't even think they noticed him come in. Thanks. As I reach to take the cup, his hand lingers a moment too long. My fingers wrap over his, and he leaves behind a folded square of paper. I look to him, and his eyes widen ever so slightly. Enough to tell me that whatever is on that paper, it's important. I close my palm over it. He gives the slightest nod, then turns to leave.
If you need anything else, he says to the room, you know where to find me.
He turns to give me a pointed look as he finishes. Then he leaves, closing the door behind him.
Here we go,
Viv says. Ronnie and Charlie peer at Viv's screen, all of them studying the information she's pulled up. While they're distracted, I shift my hold on the cup to make sure the entire paper is covered with my hand.
Okay, yes, okay.
Viv drags with both hands over the screen, enlarging the form.
Did any of the family see the departed individual alive on or after the departure date?
Ronnie looks at me. I shake my head. No.
Are the family aware, by any other means, that the departure did not properly activate?
No, Ronnie and Charlie say together.
Is there any possibility that another party, such as a neighbor, passerby, or other individual, besides departure crew professionals, witnessed the non-departed individual alive on the designated departure date or after?
No, they repeat. Ronnie adds, we were extremely cautious. We brought her out and then into the building in the bag. Viv glances to the body bag, crumpled in the corner.
Very good.
She pauses, her eyes tracking down the screen as she scrolls with her finger.
I need you both to complete a form about the incident by the end of the day. I'll forward it to you.
She taps a few points on the screen, and Ronnie and Charlie's digipads ding on their wrists.
But otherwise, I've got it from here. Surely it goes without saying that you do not speak of this, not even to each other, ever again. And that's it?
Viv nods. She's regaining her composure quickly, and I'm grateful for it. I'm starting to feel a little better, now that someone seems to have a real plan for what to do, and the process is so simple. Ronnie and Charlie move towards the door. Well, good luck, kid, Ronnie says. Charlie gives me a quiet smile. Don't worry, he says. It'll all be set right. He means it to be comforting, but it makes my stomach twist. Will it? I thought this would be over by now, not just starting. That I'd take some sort of quick medical test, get a new date, and be taken back home. But what's going to happen to me now? Why the secrecy? Ronnie and Charlie leave, and I slip into one of the chairs. My hands clutch tightly to the cup, and the corners of Tad's folded-up paper scratch against my palm. What could be so important and so secret that front desk Tad could have to tell me? I've got to read it. I peer at Viv. She's engrossed in her screen, perusing slowly, and everything settles into a quiet. I take a long, final chug of the coffee. It's already getting cool, and every sip is more bitter than the last. Then I set the cup on the desk and push it away, tucking the paper into my fist. Viv whips her head up abruptly. Sorry, but I haven't been able to use a restroom yet today. Can I?
Oh, certainly. Door's right behind you.
Viv points, then turns back to her screen. Thanks. The bathroom is bright white and uncomfortably quiet. The only sound, the dripping faucet. I lock myself in and peel the paper from my sticky palm while I relieve myself. Then I open the note up and spread it out against my leg. His writing is awful. Thin scribbles, rushed and shaky. And who actually writes anymore? Where did he even get something to write with? M-R-R-R, it says. Or M-A-A-A? M-A-A-R? M-A-R-A. M-R-A-A? It is impossible to tell, and none of it means anything. Thank you, front desk Tad. What a help. I crumple the note into my hand to toss, and then on second thought, tear it into tiny pieces first. So much for that. At least I got to pee. I look at myself in the mirror as I wash my hands. The buzzing energy that's tingled over my skin ever since I woke up begins to fade, and I'm thinking a little clearer. Clear enough that I realize I still look like I've just rolled out of bed. This is at least one thing I have a little control over, and I claim it with a vengeance. I use the wetness on my fingers to smooth down my disheveled blonde hair, then splash some water over my face. On second thought, I take another pump of soap and rub it into my face. The best I can do right now. I hate that waxy look my skin gets when I haven't washed it. It brings out the stupid freckles that spatter across my cheeks and make me look like I'm still 10. There. I turn off the faucet and look myself over. It's a little better. I push the door open and I step back into the room. Viv is gone. Then a hand grabs me and I almost cry out, but it's only front desk Tad again. Shit! I pull my arm away. What are you doing hovering by the wall like that? Sorry, he says. He wrings his hands and his eyes flicker towards the door. Listen, if you go with them, you'll live. But life is totally different out there. It's not like in here. In here, out there, them? I blink, trying to make sense of him. He stares at me, his eyes wide, like he is trying to bore the significance of his words into me. What? The office door opens and Viv returns.
Oh, Tad, there you are. There's some people at the front desk.
Tad jumps away from me, rearranging his face into his polite front, and disappears into the hall. What was that? I shake my head and replay his words, trying to make sense of them. I can't. Did it really happen? Maybe I misunderstood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.